Hello, I'm Sandy Shepherd. I'm the publisher at Juta, responsible for UCT Press. And tonight I'm going to be moderating the Juta Talking Points panel discussion in our offices in Cape Town. The theme of the discussion is Failing Our Learners: Quality, Quantity, and Measuring the Impact of Losing Them Along the Way. And we brought together a panel of key experts in education to explore the issues facing our learners in the current educational system. Join me, along with Jonathan Jansen, Brahm, Fleisch, Nic Spaull, and Wendy Horn, as we unpack just why South Africa is lagging behind the rest of the world, and how we scientifically measure this failure and come up with concrete solutions. Education is the key factor in taking South Africa forward, and I'm sure that for all of you, South Africa's future is top of mind. So I encourage you to join this conversation, take part in it, and put your points of view across. We'll be live streaming the event, and you can find the link to access it in the video description. Also, please engage with us on social media using the hashtag Juta Talking Points to put your questions to us or to simply pose your comments. And I look forward to seeing you there.
We need to understand what it is that this instructional core is and how we can use interventions and policy to strengthen it over time. We recognize, I'm going to talk specifically about policy. There are a whole series of different policies that support or fail to support the improvement of the instructional core. The obvious example would be the curriculum. We have something called the CAPS curriculum, which is clearly substantially improved from the curriculum 2005, which we discarded, fortunately, largely because we had great intellectuals who pushed us hard when it initially came out. The curriculum clearly is superior to the CAPS curriculum, which was inappropriate, probably not just in South Africa, but anywhere in the world. But it's still very flawed. It has many, very significant weaknesses, and that contributes to the problems that we're having. But the curriculum is only one part of the broader network of policies that support the teaching and learning process. There are others as well. Probably the other major one is the pre-service teacher training. So we had a significant number of teachers who were trained in the late 1980s and early 1990s. Very few of them were provided with a really deep understanding of the teaching of reading in their pre-service training. Many of our teachers were trained as intermediate and senior phase teachers, but ultimately became foundation phase teachers because that's where the opportunities were. And we're now beginning, there's a new movement in South Africa to re-look at the training of foundation phase teachers. But the reality is the vast majority of our teachers, the average age in many of my studies of teachers are around 50 for foundation phase teachers, never received the foundation training on how to teach reading when they did their professional training as teachers. So that's another component. The continuous professional development is not helping at all. So many teachers are continuing to do professional development. Many of them are not necessarily pursuing depth in understanding the teaching of reading, but are pursuing other areas like leadership, because that's where the promotion posts lie. So we don't have a very strong continuous professional development that reinforces and strengthens the teaching or the instructional core in the early grades. One of the other main contributors has been LTSM, learning and teaching support materials, the textbooks, the books that have been provided to the schools. And while there's been a significant improvement in our thinking about that from the original formulation of LTSM under curriculum 2005, and there's now a ring-fenced amount, 30% of the non-personnel budget, the norms and standards for school funding monies, are earmarked for books, specifically for the LTSM, there is still a huge gap between what the schools are ordering and what would be necessary to provide a proper basket of resources available for schools in order to teach children effectively how to read. Part of the reason is that we're fixated as a country on a couple of things. Since the big lawsuits that took place in Limpopo and other parts of the country, departments are primarily concerned about delivering books. And if they're not concerned about delivering books, they're also concerned about the PFMA. Schools are worried about making sure that the books are there, not that the books go home, but the books are there and they can be audited, that they can demonstrate the books are there. But also many teachers don't know what a collection should look like. What would a foundation phase collection look like? What would authentic texts look like in a classroom? What kinds of graded readers would be appropriate? So many teachers don't have a comprehensive set of resources, even if there are budgets available to provide them with those kinds of tools at their disposal to become effective. Those are just the main elements, but there are many other things like teacher appraisal. We don't have people to go into the classroom with a deep understanding of the pedagogy, that they could provide both real and substantive insights to teachers about their practice. Many of them are going to check. What are they checking? They're going to check to see how many pages of the DB workbooks have been completed. So we don't have a teacher appraisal process that's supporting the improvement of the instructional core. And then there's a very important big issue, which I think Nick has been highlighting in some of his work, which is that we've got a growing class size in the early grades. So in 1995, there was an agreement at the ERC that we'd have a 40-to-1 ratio for primary schools and a 35-to-1 ratio in secondary schools. And there was lots of media attention, and many provinces suggested that their ratios were smaller. But there has been a gradual increase in those ratios. And those ratios do not really provide a good indication of what the real class sizes is. So the work that happened in RECEP, and Nick had a paper on excessive class size, suggests that in places like Limpopo, a significant portion, I think it was something in the order of 40% of learners were in classes larger than 46 per learner per class. Now, from a pedagogical perspective, if you're talking about teaching children to read, and if you read the curriculum, you recognize what one of the requirements of a teacher is to be able to spend quality time with each learner, understanding what their unique learning needs are and providing that kind of support. That's simply not possible in a class of 46. And it's not just 46. I mean, recently, last year, I did some field work, and I went to a class with 60 learners, a grade 2 class. And then this second school that I visited, there were 66 learners in that class. So this is a reality that we have got in our system where there's been a gradual increase. And for a whole lot of unique situations, the one school didn't have an extra classroom, so they had a constraint of a physical space. We have very large classes, and particularly in the early grades. So women, and predominantly women, have to teach in extremely large classes, and that is obviously not going to enhance their ability to teach effectively to children to read. So these are the sort of policy contexts within which people are working in, and we are working on them. I mean, there's no doubt that Nick Taylor and his team have worked very effectively on improving the quality of teaching of reading in the foundation phase for universities around South Africa. That's going on. There's a debate at the moment about LTSM, and I think Nic Spaull's work has shown that we can provide really good quality materials at low costs, and they're doing that in the Eastern Cape. So it's not that there isn't things happening, but I think the broad configuration of policy is not particularly sympathetic to improving the quality of early grade reading. So what we're doing now is focusing primarily on interventions to improve the instructional core. But if we're going to take those insights, and sustain them over time, it's going to be critical not only to work at interventions, but we'll also need to be thinking very carefully and very systematically at aligning policy so that policy becomes a key component of enhancing improvement of early grade reading and ensuring that not only enhancing what we're beginning to shift, but taking the process forward. And there's a big challenge because we know that once we get early grade reading right, and we will, And once we get early maths right, and we will, we're going to need to do this all over again at the intermediate phase. And we're going to need to do this all again at the senior phase and the FET. So the challenge is not just once off to solve the foundation phase reading problem. But once we begin to see our children reading, when 50% of our children in grade 3 are reading fluently, and not just reading fluently, but become active readers, the teachers are going to have to rethink what they do substantially to ensure that they harness this extraordinary enthusiasm that begins to happen and push it forward as we move into the more senior phases in the school system.
So do you think that the idea of universal coverage, a textbook per child per subject, is going to assist this? Will it cover just the foundation phase initially, the intermediate phase?
So I'm going to speak specifically from the vantage point of the foundation phase literacy in home language, because I think it's most important to focus on the home language. Initially, I was of the view, and I followed the curriculum policy, which suggested that we should have a range of different kinds of reading material, and that the core of any reading program would be a set of graded readers that would be used for group-guided reading, which is the kind of one major methodology that teachers would work with learners, and that they would be at different levels, and the teachers would have sets that would meet the specific and unique needs of different levels of reading in the class. And that's a model that was used predominantly in English-speaking schools. I mean, we've got a member of the audience who talks about the dominance of the English-speaking traditions on all of the other practices across the system. And I took at face value that that's what we needed to do, but I'm increasingly recognizing that, in fact, we need a different kind of resource. We need to recognize that resources need to be developed for the unique language demands of our schools, and that there may be a need for not necessarily a single text, because I think that when you're teaching children to read, you need to have a classroom library. That's a non-negotiable. Children need to be reading 40 books that they enjoy, and they need to get in the routine of reading books. So that a textbook will never replace that as the core to beginning to develop the habit of reading. But I do think that there's definitely a strong reason to think that a single text, a text that is rich and complex but properly deals with scope and sequence, would be a very powerful resource. And I think that Nick's work has already kind of shifted my thinking dramatically, because he's demonstrated the potential to develop such a text at a reasonable price.
Thank you. Nick, you're working on the Reading for Meaning program. Can you tell us about it and what basic priorities it addresses at the basic education level?
Sure. So the project, which is called the Funda Wande Reading for Meaning project, came out of the binding constraints work that we did for the South African presidency and the European Union. So they said, if we've got lots of problems in the South African education system, where do you start? How do you make a decision about where to allocate funding when you have limited funding and lots of problems? So we did a study where we looked at all the different kinds of constraints that are in the system to try and identify the binding constraint. And we can get into some of those if people are interested. But the conclusion of that was, we realized that if children don't learn to read for meaning in their home language within the first 3 years of school, it's basically the wheels have come off and don't get put back on. And you see the same thing in maths. So if we look at reading as being a foundational skill upon which all other skills build, our curriculum assumes that in the first 3 years of school, children learn to read and then use that skill later on throughout their schooling career. Now, most children are not totally illiterate. They have some interaction with text and usually can derive some meaning from it. Yet they're constantly falling further behind because they can't, what we would call read for meaning. So the stats from the most recent cross-national assessment, the Progress in International Reading and Literacy Study, we call it PIRLS, showed that 78% of grade 4 children cannot read for meaning in any language. So all 11 languages were assessed, right? Now, 70% of kids learn to read in an African language, not in English. So the approach that we take is that for the first 3 years, grades 1, 2, and 3, children are meant to learn to read in English. and then switch over to learn to read in their home language, and then switch over to English. Typically, very few switch over to Afrikaans in grade four, and then continue with that, and they learn English as a subject in grade one. However, if you look at the whole orientation of the system, it's not oriented towards that part of the schooling system. It is orientated towards the English part of the system. So if we look at all of the universities, what languages are teachers trained in? English, typically, and Afrikaans in Afrikaans universities. What are the texts that are available? The curriculum itself and the way that it prescribes that teaching reading happens. It talks about things like rhyme. Rhyme is not existent in African languages, most of the ones that we have in South Africa. So if we think of the five T's, so Brahm mentioned earlier the work that the Kenyan colleagues at RTI are doing, and they have something called the 5T model, which is tongue, tests, training, texts, and teaching. And every single one of those things is falling short in South Africa. So in short, our project, the Funda Wande, this Reading for Meaning project, is trying to say, how can we equip teachers to teach reading for meaning? It's not as simple as just dumping books. The early grade reading studies show that they need coaching support in the classroom and ongoing coaching support. You can't teach reading if you don't have texts and good quality texts that exist in that language. Those don't exist in most of the African languages in terms of the number. IsiXhosa, which is the language that we are doing our project in as the pilot language, there are only 246 books that exist in IsiXhosa for primary school children in the world. That's like two bookshelves, right? So even if you did get all of those, and these are not Creative Commons licensed books, typically, there's a small addition if you add Creative Commons licensed books. It's extremely expensive to do that for the entire schooling system. All training in South Africa is typically done in English and Afrikaans. And the way that we teach reading. So our project has shifted. Every kind of problem that we've encountered, we've said, okay, well, how do you overcome that problem? Because typically you can't just focus on one isolated area and think that once you've solved that, you then get to other problems. So Brahm mentioned class sizes. There's problems around texts. The most recent one that we're looking at, which is not something that any not-for-profit thing can solve, is the decline in funding. So there's a primacy actually of two things that we aren't talking about yet. One is reading that we have spoken about. The other one is high level resources, not just texts on the ground, but actually funding that's going to basic education. And what we now know as of the last 2 years is that there's a systematic decline in per pupil real expenditure over the last 10 years. So there's an 8% decline in per pupil funding over the last 8 years. And that's actually one of the main drivers of the increases in class sizes. So in 2011, the average class size for no-fee schools, which make up at least 60-70% of schools, was 43 in 2011. By 2016, that was 48, the average grade 4 classroom or the average primary school classroom. And that's driven by two things. The one is that there was a birth spike that happened in between 2003 and 2005. There was a 13% increase in births across the country, and that largely we think is because of the rollout of ARVs, and as well as the child support grant, but the leading explanation is ARVs. And that 13% birth spike that happened between 2003 and 2005 then followed through 5-6 years later, we see that 13% spike in grade one enrollments. That cohort of kids this year in 2019 is in grade nine. So if you've got a 13% extra kids per year, and it wasn't just a once-off spike, it spiked and then kind of slowly declined, you have an extra 130,000 kids per grade that are coming into the schooling system, because there's roughly a million kids per grade. So that first year, you had an extra 130,000 grade ones, and then they moved into grade two, and now you had an extra 260,000 grade ones and grade two, and so on. And you're splitting the same budget over a much larger number of kids. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the main kind of leading factors behind the class size. The second one is the power of the unions, and particularly the majority union, SATU. In the Education Labor Relations Council bargaining arrangements, the salary negotiations of teachers are higher than inflation, typically. And the types of negotiations that get made, for example, that there's a 1% performance bonus as long as your IQMS score, like a peer evaluation, is positive. 99.9% of teacher evaluations, peer-to-peer evaluations, are adequate or higher, which means everyone qualifies for that. Okay? So you have this growth in teacher salaries that outstrips inflation. So that if teacher salaries in 2010, if we look compare them now, and we look at the average basket of goods, the average basket of goods increased by about 36%. That's just regular inflation. Teacher salaries, 58% over the same period. So if we are only increasing our education budget to keep up with inflation, we actually aren't keeping up with the increases in teacher salaries, which make up basically 80% of the budget. So those two factors combined mean that the overall money that's going to every single individual child in real terms is significantly declining by about 8%. And I think it's difficult to underestimate the primacy of that, irrespective of what we're talking about, whether it's reading or one textbook or curriculum, anything. It's very difficult to think of an increase in improvement in reading outcomes if we don't address that problem.
So do you agree with the fact that so much money is being put into digitizing textbooks and workbooks for children to be rolled out to every school child over the next 6 years?
Yeah, so firstly, we missed that bullet in the budget. So the bullet came in the State of the Nation, where the president said, you know, one tablet per child, and we're starting with rural schools and all this kind of stuff. And as he said, this was like the biggest sigh, you know what I mean? That this is, it's never worked. In every country that they've done one tablet per child, Colombia, Peru, Los Angeles, Kenya, India, some states in India, wherever they've tried this, it's failed. And this was the advice that we gave the finance minister and the president. It's like, don't do one tablet per child. It doesn't work. So he mentions it in the State of the Nation, but the State of the Nation is this kind of wish list, right, that the president puts out there. National health insurance, one tablet per child. There's a whole bunch of things that are fabulous. You know, it's like the Freedom Charter. There shall be houses. It's like, it doesn't actually manifest in houses, right? And then the budget, which follows soon after that, is the actual, not just the shopping list, the wish list shopping list. It's actually what's in the trolley. So, I mean, what do we have money to pay for? There's nothing in there for NHR. There's also nothing in there for tablets. Unfortunately, there's also nothing in there for reading, specifically. So I like to think that the kind of best and worst of sonar was left out of the budget. Best being reading, worst being tablets. So I definitely don't think that a one tablet per child policy is the right approach. It's difficult to overestimate how expensive that policy would be. So the Click Foundation, which they've run a lot of different different implementations of tech in schools, they asked Nicola Harris, who runs this, what is the actual tech expenditure? And she said the hardware costs are only about 25% of the implementation at a school. So 75% of the costs are actually training, maintenance, support, tech issues, a whole bunch of other things. And we're just looking at this 25% and saying, do we think we can afford the 10, 15, 40 billion rand that's going to cost to roll out these devices to 12 million children without looking at the under the iceberg, this huge section? And there's absolutely no evidence that this is the right way to do it. We like to think that this is the way you get prepared for the fourth industrial revolution, which is just bullshit, to be frank.
Thank you. So Wendy, your school is a maths and science school, is tech driven. I have two questions. One is, how do children transition from primary school with all these problems into a school like yours? And how are you preparing children for the fourth industrial revolution in this scenario?
Well, I think I want to just start off by saying tech is not the answer. It's not the tablet that prepares the critical thinking skills or the communication or the collaboration, all the skills that are being identified as required for this fourth industrial revolution, which is apparently already. So we use technology to support the teaching of critical thinking skills. So that is, it's just a support mechanism. It's not the silver bullet that's going to solve it. If we still use textbooks and we still use old talk and talk, we could teach the same critical thinking skills. It's just that we can engage the learners much more with what they are used to, what they want to see and learn. So you get their interest, you're able to capture them, they get very excited about what they are doing. So it's that factor. It's more of trying to get the children where they are and talk to them where they are, rather than talk to them where we are, where I was with chalk and talk. So the learners that come from the primary schools to us generally are completely unprepared. Many I get can't switch a computer on. They've done very little computer type skills at primary school, have not really engaged with tech generally. So we go through the whole first of grade eight is just used in preparation. It's a whole orientation. We take it slowly. We take them through a whole series of lessons, which we mold within the CAP syllabus, because I've heard the CAP syllabus being mentioned here, which is a big stumbling block for us, because we have to tick the boxes, but we're trying to do something different. So we read a sentence in the CAP syllabus, like in technology, they must, be able to design something. So we read that, and then we twist it, and we make it work for us in terms of how we are going to integrate critical thinking skills with the use of technology and the sciences. So it takes a long time to get the learners ready. So when our grade 8s come in, talk about reading, our baseline results are shocking. 70% of our grade 8s who come in from grade 7 don't read at the right level. Their maths is even worse. And then we now must get them ready for tertiary educations. Got to get them. So I don't really focus on matric, because what is a matric certificate? We're now trying to get them ready for tertiary education. And now we got to start preparing them. It is a huge amount of work that goes in. And I don't think when they leave my school, they're ready. But I do my very best to give them a piece of paper which says they passed maths and science and they are able to get into university. And they're not ready. But it's the best that we can do with what we get from the primary schools. I understand the pressure of the primary school. You've got the extra 130,000 coming through. Your next group is coming. You need to push this group through. What are you going to do with them in a class of already 46? You can't keep 10 or 20 back. You push them on, and you keep pushing them on, and they eventually get to us. And when we get them in grade 8, sometimes we now identify lots of learning barriers, and you wonder, how is this not picked up in primary school? I mean, high school teachers are the worst. We blame the primary school teachers for everything because they just don't know what they're doing. Because you pick up a child can't read in high school in grade 8. So you wonder, how did that miss, get missed in the primary school? But if you've got a class of 46, and our neighboring primary school, which is generally a good primary school, they have classes of 40, and they are X model C school with generally good school fees, but their classes are 40. And the learners get pushed through, and because the classes are so big, the teachers aren't able to identify what is going on in the class. And even in a small class of 35, where I teach, I can't really identify what is going on in my class. I pick it up now and then in an assessment or when we do formative work. But generally, at that moment, I don't know if that child I'm teaching actually knows what's going on, because I can't get to everybody in 50 minutes and make sure they are on board with me. So talking about the fourth industrial revolution, some of the things we do are mostly learner-driven at our school. So the learners push us hard. They come up with all sorts of innovative ideas. When we started in 2015, we started with a little bit of 3D printing, which we got a company to assist us with. And the learners soon came up with the idea that they wanted to have a printer at school. So they fundraise. They did the whole Valentine's dance thing, and we raise funds, and we have a 3D printer. We started with one or two of my teachers started with Google, my IT teachers, and then the kids wanted to know, why aren't the rest of us using Google Classroom? So they forced us. Even my language teachers now have to use, they had to get on board with IT and the tech. And they're always showing us things. One came to me today to show me, the Elon Musk's rockets and things that are launching, and he wants to discuss all the stuff with me. So the kids are there. They want to learn. They're so curious, and we kill it with a CAP syllabus. We just take all that curiosity, and we just want to tick the boxes. Have I written two essays, and give them such boring topics to write about, and all that type of thing. So it is difficult for us teachers on the ground and us principals, because we have to tick the boxes. We get, as you said, the CAs come in, they tick, they write reports, you haven't met this requirement, it goes to the head office, they come back to you, you haven't met the requirement, you need to explain why, and so on. So in that narrow sort of knife edge, you try and comply, you try and innovate, but it is not easy to do that. So
I mean, we've heard about how teachers are not adequately coached or mentored. It takes, in my mind, quite an extraordinary teacher to be teaching maths and science in that kind of environment. Yet we have them.
When I started the school, I was in the WCD had a policy at that point that we could only take beginner teachers. So I'm a brand new school with 10 posts. And so I get 7 beginner teachers, which have an average of 2 years experience between them and then myself and my 2 heads of department. So that's how we started, with 7 totally inexperienced teachers, grade 8s and grade 9s. And it took a huge amount of work to mentor them and get them ready. And I agree with what has been said here about teacher training. It is inadequate. A PGCE where a teacher goes in to a classroom for a term and then they can, now they are expert teachers, they come in, their first year of any teacher, there's some teachers here, it's terrible. You will cry most nights. And you get many leaving because it is absolutely terrible. You're not prepared. The discipline of the children, the workload, the pedagogy, you don't know what you're doing. You are so lost. And you need to have a strong mentorship within a school. And I think that's what we have to do in our own particular schools. I don't think policy can solve it. I don't think universities can solve it. I think within schools, there needs to be a strong training that's happening, but not just training. Training is pointless. It is mentorship. It's every day being able to go into a teacher's classroom and say, this is what you're doing right. This is what you're doing not so right. Let's try and fix this. Just walking with my science teachers, just having them all together in one teaching block so we can go in the corridor when it's change of class and I look on the board, what are you doing there? And they come and look on my board and we can see that type of training is invaluable. That is the learning that needs to happen. And one of the things I've been chatting to Professor Robinson at Stellenbosch University is about running a teaching school. So where students come for the whole year, if not longer, and actually are in the school suffering with everybody else, so that when they become teachers, they've been through the whole process, not just a 6-week snapshot of what is going on. And I think that would really change the way teachers are prepared for going into the classroom.
Thank you. Professor Jansen, you spent your whole life in education, and you've covered all phases of the education path. I wonder what thoughts you have in response to the panelists.
Sure. So I think the first thing I want to say is that in our country at the moment, there are absolutely incredible things happening with respect to, where is this thing? Incredible things happening with respect to teaching and learning and so on. Not a day goes by where somebody doesn't come into my office with something that just blows me away, like the Math Moms project in Elsie's River, where the small group of church people teach unemployed mothers mathematics so that when their kids come home from school, they can be, and some of those Math Moms have now become math teachers, which is just amazing. So all across the country, there are little things like this. What we're also blessed with, thanks to, as in the case of the work in Brackenfell, what we're also blessed with for the first time, actually, in a very long time, is really outstanding research, empirical research, on what is going on in schools. And Brahm and Nic are among the leaders, I think, on our continent in giving us really good work with that respect. My difficulty is, however, that when you look at the system of schools, not the individual innovations, we're all involved in that, not in the research on foundation phase per se, etc. We make 3 assumptions that are fatalistic or really fatal for our understanding of change. The first assumption that we make is that teachers actually want to teach. It's a really simple thing, but the assumption that every South African teacher or most of them want to show up and teach is not something that I have found, especially in high schools, to be valid. We've just done, as you know, a study of 30 primary schools running along the main road here from Fishhook to the City Bowl. I mean, including today, my visit to Saks. I mean, I am astounded, not just by the opulence of the schools, but some wealthy schools in relation to GDP per cent spent on a kid. And every teacher's in there, and every teacher's busy, and every teacher's running, and every teacher just came from some grade 5 camp with a pre. No, seriously, I mean, you literally see people running. But that's not what I see in Langa. That's not what I see in Bonteo. That's not what I see in Amanzimtoti. That's not what I see when I go to schools around the country and so on for our various projects.
So the assumption that teachers want to teach is a hugely misguided assumption, okay, when it comes to the issue of change. I'm not saying there aren't many teachers who want to teach. I'm just saying that when I go to Oscar Mbetha High School in Nyanga, and the teachers are all sitting for the entire day in the staff room, okay, and the kids are waiting in the class. You see, that's my reality, especially with high schools. That's what I see. You know, when at Mamelodi High School, the kids are out every day, including today, at 12 o'clock. That's my reality that I see. So the assumption that the teachers want to teach is a hugely problematic assumption. Okay, the second big assumption is that the teachers want to change. Why would a South African teacher want to change, given that this is now, what, the third or fourth coming of the curriculum? Right? You know, there's something in the literature called curriculum fatigue. You just add one more district official who doesn't know too much to begin with in most of the provinces. Okay, these are basically what Richard Elmo calls overheads. Okay, they're really overheads. They're not adding anything fundamental to teaching and learning. And now you tell me there's yet another curriculum, and what right now is for me with CAPS, I actually now made an effort because I don't study government policy anymore because it's just depressing. So I actually went through and studied CAPS. It's the biggest load of bull you can do in a country with the aspirations that we have. It's really dumbing down the kids. It's as if we didn't learn from the 1960s that you can't teach a proof curriculum. I mean, you're going through the same stuff. You know, every time South Africans say something, they like to pretend they're the first to say it. So the kids run around on campuses and say decolonization, and everybody says, wow, what a wonderful concept. You know, nobody else talks about it, okay, but us, because we're always Johnny-come-latelys or Sibo-come-latelys when it comes to these things. So the notion that the teachers want to change. So I spent a lot of time recently in the behavioral sciences. I know it's an outmoded sort of term, but it makes a lot of sense to me. Is how do you change people's behavior, okay? Not just their knowledge, but their behavior. And we're struggling with this, but don't assume the teachers want to change. The third thing, and this is where the research is really good, is we assume that the teachers know. So when President Ramaphosa gets up and talks about tablets in every school, I mean, I wanted to throw up, you know. I'm sure he didn't read it. Somebody, as with all the various government departments, they write their wish list, they give it to the president, they cut and paste. And the poor president has to get up and talk this shit, you know. And Nick is correct, this is bullshit of the highest order, okay? You want to talk about that, but right down the road, kids are drowning in their own shit. How can you, okay, get away with this kind of thing? And so I want to come to what we do know for sure is that the teachers, many of our teachers don't know what to teach, so there's a content problem. But they also don't know how to teach, okay? So I'm not going to use big words here, but that's actually the two big things. Do I know enough mathematics to teach at grade 9 level, at the grade level? And do I know how to teach mathematics? Okay, as a subject, which is a completely different proposition. So our assumptions, and this started with outcomes-based education, our assumptions that we have a wonderful system that is going to be receptive to whatever government coughed up based on a cursory visit, as Nick pointed out to my students this morning, based on a cursory visit to Australia by Adrian Bird, you know, guess what? Our system will just receive this nonsense. We're making fundamentally wrong assumptions about the state of the system. And the big question is, as Edward Said asked in the context of racism, when everybody was South Africans jumping up and down saying the country is racist and so on, right here in Kirstenbosch, Edward Said, before he died, says, don't tell me there's racism in your society. In other words, of course, there's supposed to be racism after 350 years. Tell me what sustains it. So let me give you a sense of what keeps the system in place. The first thing that keeps it in place is we have absolutely no accountability built into the school system. And SATA won't even allow you to speak about accountability. So I met yesterday with the senior managers from EXA. No engineer gets anywhere in this country unless they meet the EXA standards for what it means to be an engineer. No accountant gets anywhere in this country unless they meet SAICA standards for what it means to be an accountant. Nobody gets anywhere in the practice of optometry unless you have met the standards set by the Health Professions Council of South Africa. But for teaching, you can get away with murder, literally, okay? And SAICA is, I mean, you know, a lame duck, as far as you're concerned. You just saw the stories about pedophile teachers. Even simple things like protecting our children from pedophiles, I can't even get that right. you know. So we're sitting with a system that has no accountability, and accountability for me is a good word. And you know where this thing started? This started with the Soweto protest of 76. Many of us were involved, many of us hailed it. What we didn't see is what else got lost in the fire. And let me tell you something. For all the people, particularly liberals drive me nuts, you know, for all the white liberals at UCT applauding the protests of 2015-16, and there's a lot to applaud, let me be clear. What we're not watching is what else was lost in the fire. And I tell you what was lost in the fire. UCT is no longer a place in which you can say what you think without fear, okay, of being run down, literally. Adam Habib cannot launch his own book, he tells me, at Wits University without the threat of a major security breach, okay? A university is the one place in society when you can talk absolute rubbish, okay, and be allowed to do that, in which you can have novel ideas. UCT has up on its website one of the dumbest documents I've ever seen in curriculum studies, and it's called the Curriculum Change Framework. It's done by a small group of black nationalists, okay, all in the name of freedom. But these are people who know nothing about curriculum theory. So they put up this document. Do you know, in the 50 interviews we did at UCT and another 50 at Wits, the UCT people said, we dare not say anything about that document. It would be political suicide. I'm quoting progressive people. I'm not talking about the reactionaries. I'm talking about progressive people. So what else is lost in the fire, okay, is that we have built two systems, a system for schools and a system for universities, in which you can no longer hold people accountable for rubbish, okay, for nonsense. And this is, I think, we're going to pay a heavy price for this in the future. We don't have any system of support. We learned from the cascade model. Remember that, Brahm? Everybody taught cascades in the late 1990s. But we knew it didn't work. And I don't know of another model that works at the level of scale than mentoring teachers with outstanding mentors in science, in mathematics, in principal leadership, and so on. There's no other model that works. The upfront costs are high, but eventually you're able to recoup your investments in that. And then your gullibility. All of you are gullible. I'm so sorry. You all look decent, but you are gullible. So when President Ramaphosa gets up and talks about the tablet in every school, I didn't hear a public outcry. I hear everybody, oh, wow, we're with it. You know, we might. And nobody asks why Namibia has a national airline that costs them billions of rands and puts them millions of rands into debt every year, not understanding that this stuff has got nothing to do with teaching and learning. It's got everything to do with appearing to be modern, appearing to be part of the world system at the cost of our children. So we buy into what I call miracle ideology. Think of this. Here is a pastor, okay, from Congo, and an apparently dead man from Zimbabwe. Surrounded by a group of Africans. And they fucked us. I mean, yeah, you know. And the South Africans, who are so bloody naive because we came into democracy so late. The Congolese pastor raises this man from the dead. Nobody saw the cell phone in his pocket, which was a dead giveaway, you know. And we believed it, you know, until everybody, you know, started to make fun of the thing. My point is, we into this, what is Mary called? I don't often quote Mary for good reason. But what kind of thinking does she call it?
Magical thinking.
We're really into this magical thinking. We really think if you announce something, you're going to get it. And you are all gullible. When the minister gets up every year and lies to your face about the matric results, we get hammered for saying, but wait a minute, this is not true. Okay? And for the first time since Kada Asmo, the Department of Basic Education took out a full-page advert to attack me, Professor Jansen and his ilk. They used the word ilk 5 times, which suggested they didn't know what it means. But instead of fixing the system, our role in a democracy is to be a public nuisance. That's what people do, are public figures. You're a public nuisance. You ask questions that are uncomfortable. You don't take out ads at the taxpayer's expense to go and attack other people. So this magical thinking that you are now forced to be part of, okay, is partly what lands us in this trouble. Now, here's the question that I ask when I visit these 30 schools, and some of them are so wealthy. I mean, I I've never seen anything like this before in primary school, anywhere in the world. And I spent a good chunk of my life in Palo Alto, California, which, as Nic will tell you, is not a poor place in the Silicon Valley. And I say to myself, why is it not offensive to this government that you can have so much inequality built into the school system? And this is visible inequality, okay? This is, you actually see the AstroTurfs and the water polo pools and the, and I said, and why is this not offensive? And I tell you why, because the middle classes opt out of dealing with these difficult issues. That is where you take, just look at where every cabinet minister sends their kids to school. I can assure you it's not La Plaza High School or Langa High School or Marienburg High School. It is to these very schools in which their interests are tied up with the interests of white elites. Okay, and who gets screwed? The poor. Okay, and so there's no incentive in the political system to deal with this inequality because it's in the interest of the black elite as it is in the interest of the white elite to keep the system going. So my friend Derek Bell at Harvard got it absolutely wrong when he said in the context of their struggles with school desegregation that the reason whites changed and allowed for something like Brown versus Board of Education, which declared separate schooling unconstitutional, is because the interests of whites, you know, happen to coincide with the interests of the protesters. That's not true in South Africa. In South Africa, the interests of these middle classes actually coincide to keep out the poor. I mean, just take, this is something that grieves me at the level, because I grew up here, because I know the Western Cape and its politics. What grieves me deeply is that you take a run down these schools and ask them how many black African, not how many colored students, that's easy. How many black African students do you have in your class? You will be shocked. It's a disgrace, okay? And yet the system is allowed to continue unrestricted. I don't know of another way out of this other than for ordinary people to stand up and challenge this nonsense. Not rich people, they're not gonna do it. This parliament is not gonna do it. And so my hope lies in a school called, I think, De Crane in Towser River last week. I don't know if you saw what happened there. The kids in Towser River went to the home of the teacher and said, get your butt back to school.
No,
we demand that you teach us. Maybe that's the solution.
Thank you. On that rousing note, I'm getting very depressed. I'd like to hand over the question mark. Please just put your hand up and somebody with a rosy mic will come through. Let's take three at a time.
Hi there. I'm a high school English teacher in a government school, and last week I met another government school teacher from a place where they don't have a governing school body, so can't afford supplementary teachers. Over 70 kids in each class. The teacher was absolutely desperate, absolutely burnt out, and exhausted. And put my 35 kids in five classes in context. I don't know what support there is for teachers. My experience is that there is a lot of dictatorship about what happens in the classroom and how we meant to, for language teachers, we are reeling under the marking system. I do not know how people with 70 kids in a class cope. The language teachers told me, there was a history teacher also from a school down the road with 46 kids in the class. She said that she had no technology in her class. She had one textbook which had recently been stolen because tests were coming up and the kids wanted to do well. And so her textbook had been stolen and the kids were afraid that if they brought theirs to class, it would be stolen. Now, I'm not telling you anything you don't know. But what I am wondering is why it is the teachers who do want to teach are not being properly supported. When I ask what happens at departmental level in terms of the ridiculous marking level that high school teachers are expected to deal with, And I'm just told, well, I'm afraid there's nothing you can do. It's in other, and just as an aside, in the school where there were 70 kids in a class, in her grade 10 class, she was talking about how there was an influx of Eastern Cape kids who were coming in who were functionally illiterate. And she was saying, I'm already teaching every afternoon extra English for my grade 11s and 12s. When and how? When and how? So my question is really about teachers who do want to teach and what has been done about supporting those.
Hi, my name is talked about how the students from grade 1 up until like grade 12, they somehow, the number of output that we get at the end of that 10 years does not actually correspond to the number that gets into the system in that at the beginning of that 10 years. But now, looking at what happens between that 10 years, there are a bunch of other of students that actually get stuck in the system. But now let's look at the bunch of students that actually get out of the system. And we talk about, like when we talk about those students, yes, the dropouts. So I'm talking about the dropouts. Now, the issues that we have are like the psychological issues. We've seen like recently students beating teachers, stuff like that. So what are we doing in terms of like setting up the psychological behaviors of the students in order to prepare them to actually be able to stay within the system and not be able to like, to not be kicked out or be outside the system within that, that period of 10 years. And another question I had was, so we talked about the fact that if we had to, that goes to Nic. That was on the Reading for Meaning project. And the purpose of it was to say, okay, let's teach people to read for this 3 years for me. And the issue that you raise was the issue that we don't actually have enough books for people to like for these children to like learn Zulu or Sisutu or just for me. Now what are we doing to actually encourage the teachers that are teaching in the primary schools to actually participate in the development of the content, in the development of the curriculum in which like all these education is like taught. Because if you look at the books that gets delivered in the schools, especially in the rural areas, look at how many books are actually written by the teachers who actually teach in the rural areas. Because the teachers, they literally like follow the curriculum to the T, but do not actually innovate and put in the efforts to say, okay, how do I take out my views and add into the curriculum? How do I make this curriculum what is suitable for my own students and stuff like that? So,
I'm Tanya. I'm a teacher at a primary school. It sounds like an AA meeting.
Welcome.
Professor Nic mentioned that if a child hasn't mastered reading, understanding what he's reading within the first 3 years, then you said the wheels come off. And Ms. Headmaster said, you mentioned groups of large numbers of children being pushed through our system. Now these two go together. To me, I cannot understand why our system works like this. A child can only fail once in a phase. So I understand about this birth spike and all the children has to, but what do they win? By having a policy like this, that a child, you cannot progress, but you already failed grade one. Now you have to pass grade two and grade three. The moment you reach grade four, you still read on grade
four. So
it just escalates. And that is when a child reaches the high school and he still reads on a grade three level, and high school teachers ask what goes on in the primary school. Aren't the teachers doing their jobs? Yes, we are trying our best, but we only have what we are dealt, what the department gives us to work. So I want to know, why can't money be spent if a child cannot progress in the primary school? Why can't children be, I don't know how to put it in English, hoekom kan hulle nie sideways geskuif word na soos die oukeise special needs skole nie, where they can receive a proper education that is at their level, and at least they still have a self-image. They are not mocked. They are not dropouts. Why isn't this? Hoekom word dit nie geakkommodeer nie? Wat hierdie colleague ook gesê het van, jy het iets gesê, sorry, die glas wyn het in my kop gegaan. Wat hy, het hy ook gepraat van iets wat my, van kinders by onderwysers, kop en sikker goed is, things like that, it happened in classes of 60 and so on and so forth. En dis kinders wat daar gedruk word. A lot of them don't want to be there, they can't keep up with the schoolwork, and they are frustrated. But this is how our system works. Why can't we have a system in place that sidetracks those children to somewhere where they can also be successful? Instead of everybody must have an academic degree. It's ludicrous. Thanks, Bachus, but that's why.
Who would like to answer the questions on teachers who want to teach what they have?
Can I start by responding to Jonathan? I mean, Jonathan...
That was a long wait. It's like, I'm going to listen to all of you, but I actually just want to tell Jonathan something.
No, I mean, I think Jonathan raised three really very powerful questions, and I want to kind of reframe it. So I don't work in high schools anymore. I work in primary schools, and I work in rural schools. I work in Limpopo. I work predominantly in Mpumalanga in the Northwest. And I've seen something completely different than Jonathan. And what I've seen is that we actually have finished teachers.
What?
Finished teachers. And what I mean by that is that the majority of the teachers in these rural primary schools were the top of their high school graduating classes. These women, and they're predominantly African women, were by far the smartest group of people in their whole group. And they succeeded beyond despite the fact that they came from very poor primary schools and very poor high schools. And they are, in many respects, one of our great national assets. These are women predominantly in their late 40s, early 50s. And I think that we need to recognize that they're a huge asset for the system. These are primary school teachers, women, and the reason why they're there was if you were an African woman in the late 80s, and you were a high school graduate and you did well, you could go into nursing and you could go into teaching. And many of them have stayed because there haven't been many other opportunities along the way. The problem is many of them received extremely poor teacher training. They don't receive the kind of support that they need to flourish as good foundation phase teachers. That said, I've been to a school where the teacher wasn't there the day and the principal said, yeah, she's tired. She hasn't been teaching. So there are teachers, and I don't want to pretend otherwise. There are teachers that should be exiting the system because they're tired, they've stopped teaching. But there is a significant number of rural teachers in their late 40s, early 50s who do want to fulfill the mission that they have been doing for the last 25 years. And they haven't got the resources. They haven't got what it needs to actually make them become successful in what they need to do. And one of the key things for me is that they are very jaded. And you raise that. You raise the fact that many of them have been through not one, but two, but three rounds of curriculum reform. So one of the big challenges is how to begin to get them to break down that reservation, that mask, that incredible concern that they have about whether they can trust the system to do the right thing. And that's a challenge that we have to do. And one of the things that's emerging in our project, and one of the reasons why coaching works and why training doesn't, cascade or otherwise, is that coaching is about that interpersonal relationship. That the coach needs to develop a trusting bond with the teacher before the teacher can begin to think about new ways of teaching. So I think there's, in this kind of incredibly complex environment that we're working on, and I have a perspective from the teacher, there are innovations that are beginning to recognize that we can move to the next level, that there are massive resources, intellectual, human resources in our society that can bring us to where we need to go. There are challenges that are insurmountable, and I think Nick is right. We're under enormous financial constraints, and every teacher feels it. We have a system that is top-down where our system administrators have no idea how to change it, so they use fiat, they use policy restrictions or policy rules in order to change the journey. And I think that's obviously going to be very counterproductive. But I do want to stress from my own work that there is enormous potential out there, and that there is an underlying strength in our teaching profession that will take us to the next level.
How do you explain the fact? You see, I don't buy that, okay? I maybe I live in another world, okay? You still have to come to terms with the fact that the latest research that we have on instructional time spent in school still puts South Africa way below. In other words, that even though you might be physically present in the school, if you look at the HSRC data, for example, going back there, there's a third of the instructional time that is lost to school. Now, that means you didn't show up. And I don't care how you explain that. If you get paid and get paid relatively well, you still have to show up. So there's a guy that I'm supporting now. He taught in LA. If you teach in parts of LA, trust me, it's a very dangerous proposition. And he says, you know, he taught for years in LA. He's now teaching here in township schools in South Africa. And he said, you know, the big difference between when I taught in LA and now that I'm in South LA and teaching now in South Africa, he says, there the teachers actually wanted to teach. And the parents were out of it. He says, yeah, the teachers don't want to teach. And the parents, you know, seem to want to make things happen. I don't deny, please don't misrepresent what I'm saying. I don't deny that there are good, I wrote a book called Great South African Teachers, precisely with the idea of showing up the teachers that do well. But we are misleading ourselves if we think that you have a highly productive system in the very basic sense of showing up and delivering your work, regardless of whether you're teaching right or wrong. We don't. And that worries me greatly, because that speaks not to pedagogy, that speaks to culture. That speaks to the organizational culture of the school, the stuff Seymour Saddison talked about, okay? How do you impact on that reality? And we've got a problem. I've worked in schools in Mozambique, the teachers are there. I've worked in Namibia, I've worked in Botswana. Whenever I go into the schools, there is an activity. You come here, and the only place you see that level of productivity, I'm sorry to say, is in white African schools, where the teachers don't walk. They call it the draft stuffing. Hear me now. So I just want to, if I may just respond to one. I don't think these are answers, Sandy, but just responses. Look, if you listen to what I said earlier, this is not going to go away. And if you think 60 in a class is a lot, go with me to Mansum Toti, where we're working with the older teacher at the moment, and there's 170 kids in a grade 7 mathematics classroom, where I couldn't even see the teacher from where I was sitting at the back. Go Nubi in the Eastern Cape. Go and look at some of the class sizes there. So this is not unfamiliar. The question is, why doesn't it change? And it's not going to change simply because we get together and say it's a problem. It's going to change, I believe, through activism. It's going to change by people embarrassing the government. That's why government responds to fees must fall, which we can't afford, by the way. You might afford it this year. Trust me, you can't afford that with this kind of economy. But they don't respond to ECD, which is so obviously the place in which you rebuild the system. Okay? And why? Because grade three kids, 3-year-olds don't jump over the gates of parliament. So the system responds to political pressure. And what I say to schools, if you have a situation like that, let's talk about a strategy to make this politically uncomfortable for those in power. But simply complaining about it, simply reporting to your circuit manager in the hope that this gets to Brian Schroeder, you're wasting your time.
Nick wants to say.
I just wanted to ask something similar to Brahm. The points that Jonathan made, and I think it speaks to the first question about what about the teachers that do actually want to teach? And it's one of the things that we don't have nationally representative data to be able to verify Brahm's point of are all of these teachers actually the bright shining stars of their generation? And they actually are these motivated people? Or is it more what Jonathan's saying, where the majority of teachers are actually whatever the adjective is that you would use to describe them? But I do think that what we can probably conclude is that it's very difficult to hold people accountable for things that they can't do and that they've never been equipped to do. And that when you try and hold people accountable for things that they can't do, they typically respond militantly and try to subvert the aims of an accountability system. So Richard Elmore writes a lot about this, where his logic is your capacity has to precede accountability. So it's not that they shouldn't be held accountable for physically arriving at school, being able physically present at the school and teaching. But when a teacher doesn't teach fractions, a grade six teacher, one of the reasons is probably because they don't know how to teach it and they were never taught it well themselves. It's very difficult to say that we should hold that kind of a teacher accountable for the fact that they haven't. So I think the first point is problematic that teachers want to teach. And I think the answer is start with the ones that do want help. So we don't actually need to make a decision now if it's 10% or 70% of teachers that are bad eggs. We can say for the percentage, whatever that amount is, that want that support, start there. So that's our kind of, I don't know who's doing that one. That's our kind of approach, which is don't try and help people that don't want help. Start with the teachers that do actually want the support. The second point that teachers want to change and doubting that teachers do want to change, I think that's linked to agency. When you see the links between cause and effect, what Brahm was talking about, of once teachers see kids learning to read because of effective practice, they often become more motivated than they were before. And your kind of last point about that, we assume that teachers know, we know that they don't. So again, large scale representative data, this is my one that's doing this. Large-scale representative data shows, so grade six teachers, 79% of grade six teachers can't do grade six maths. They can't get 60% correct on a grade six or seven level test. Nationally representative primary school, 423. So I think that the answer is probably working with the teachers that we have and offering them what Yale would call meaningful learning opportunities, which we haven't done. I think this type of coaching opportunity is probably the first one of that. And the second one is recruiting better teachers into the system.
Can I just add to that? Talking about teachers who want to teach and teachers that don't want to teach, we as teachers are our own worst enemies. You marking 400,000 essays, and I'm a principal, and I see my English teachers and Afrikaans teachers working themselves to a standstill. And so why don't they say, I'm just not going to do these essays? All the English teachers, why don't we just say, we're not going to mark his essays. We're not going to do 15 orals. But because we, as teachers, I don't know, it's in our genes or something, we just want to comply. It's always the child, the poor child. If I don't mark his essay, then that poor child's not going to get that mark. And then we complain. We all complain, but we just continue doing it. And what Professor Jansen's talking about, activism, you know, you read on Facebook posts where all teachers are posting how angry everybody is about things, and then somebody will say, well, let us all meet and let's get together, and then nothing will happen because we're all marking and we are all busy, so we're not going to meet, and therefore nothing will ever change. So I don't know how the system is going to change. And I mean, I'm a culprit. So when somebody calls for a strike, I'm the first person to say, oh, I can't strike because what can happen to my children? I must be at school because I must open the gates because where are the children going to go? And then I have half my staff will probably say the same thing and then it won't work. So I'm not sure how the mindset of teachers in general, those that want to teach, are going to change. And then those that don't want to teach are not going to turn up anyway because they're not at school anyway. They are, as we say in teaching, you know, the bar that they go to, the end of the month bar is where they probably are. And then some of the questions, the one on the development of the curriculum, where we're pushing learners through the system and they can only fail once in a phase. That is extremely frustrating for all of us, even in high school, where you've got learners having to go through. I do think in high school, we have the multiple opportunities where a matric learner can write exams over 2 years. Don't think it really works, but that is available. We need more teachers from somebody. We need specialized people, so if the child can't read, they mustn't be sidelined into a different school. You need somebody to come into your class, a support system, will sit with that learner one-on-one or one-on-two, work with them in the class, get them up to speed with reading. But we do not have the money and the resources.
It's 80% of the kids in the class. It's not the three or four that we can put into a side system. If we believe the stats that these 78% of kids, it's the whole class can't read. And we can't put 78% of the system into remedial schools. Do you know what I mean? If the point is the whole system, the foundation phase teachers are not currently equipped to teach kids to read.
Yeah.
That's the issue that we have to...
I just want to be very careful with the two of you. Because you also have to be very careful, also given who you are, to not depict all of the teachers in the system, or even most of the teachers in the system, as not knowing. Because that makes us the knowers, and they don't know. I think that's highly problematic too. Even though I acknowledge, of course, that there is a problem with knowledge. But I think a lot of the things going on in the system at the moment is not because people don't know and therefore they opt out. That's too easy an explanation. It's because you've never been held, as in any other profession, accountable for your actions. So let me give you an example. I spent 3 months preparing recently for a really intense teacher and principal development workshop at Langa High School. 2 hours before I get there, the principal says, look, they all ran off to a SATU meeting. I can't deal with that. I can't deal with that level of irresponsibility as a professional person, okay? And so we just be very careful not to overstate the case here about ignorance when it comes to particularly teachers in schools, even though we certainly have a problem. I want to go to the question of getting out, dropping out, and so on and so forth. I don't blame kids for dropping out if the people who teach don't make it worth their while being there in the first place. I never had a problem with dropouts, and I taught in some fairly scary high schools. And the reason is I made sure that when you came to school, including on Saturdays when I taught, it was the best experience you would ever get in biology education. But kids don't drop out because they necessarily want to get out. They get drop out because they're pushed out of a system. If your teacher isn't there every day, if the school's timetable is erratic, you know, then of course you've got a problem. So I'm also have given up. I just want to be honest with you. We all used to do these studies of exceptional schools, and there's so many exceptional schools in terrible situations around the country. There's this beautiful school where they raped and murdered this poor kid at the age of 13 in Lavendale, and I was there the other day to celebrate the opening of their library. And you know what was really interesting about going to that school was the level of dedication of all of those teachers to reading. Nick would enjoy it. It was absolutely. But as I'm listening to, I arrive and I sort of try and move around the school before the function. And here comes a teacher with a growing bunch of kids from one of the classrooms. They say, Kasato, you're very bad. And I said, you know what? I'm going to raise this issue in my talk. Because all he's doing is reinforcing, okay, the very bad behavior that this kid probably experiences at home and in the area, in the school. So the school has to be the place that you put a brake on bad behavior. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. And so on and so forth. Yeah.
Should we take another round of questions? But I would also like to say to those of you who've tuned in to the live stream, please send your questions via the chat, and we'll be recording them and we'll get them answered.
Hi, my name is Janet Condy, and I teach at a local university here where I train teachers. I've been training teachers for over 20 years. Last year we graduated, in 2018 we graduated a lot of teachers. I'd like to just take you back to when they were first years. In first year, it was 2015. They were students who'd applied to our university to many campuses, but were accepted all over and selected the easiest course, which was teaching. So they came into first year. 2015, 16, 17, we had the riots. They missed 2 months of every year of education. In their fourth year, they get the Funzelishaka bursary. They get paid in March. In March, they have beautiful hair, beautiful eyebrows, lovely nails, designer clothes. Then they don't attend class because they've got no money. So the attendance rate for the whole year is 30% because they don't have money to attend classes. And then they graduate. And these are the teachers now who have not selected teaching because they love teaching, but have been accepted into teaching. We have missed 6 months of education because of the riots, have attended 30% of their final year of education, and now are not wanting to go into teaching because they know they're not prepared, and all wanting to go on and do honours because it's an easy way out. They don't want to be in schools because it's hard work.
My question is not dissimilar to the one that has been held, and I wonder if Nic Spaull, whether you have any statistics on the quantity of young people coming into teaching or coming out of the universities into the schools, and secondly, whether there's any quantity control on those teachers coming into the game. What did I say? Quality control of those teachers.
Hi there. I'm not sure if I dare to say this, but I'm unashamedly from UCT. I'm Kathy Kell. And yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for the very interesting inputs and really exciting ideas and I think many hopeful threads throughout what people are saying. I just want to say that last year a couple of us at UCT more broadly wrote a paper called How Are We Failing Our Children? We did circulate very widely to people here, to many people here. And we raised some questions about how we theorize literacy. And I think I'm just wanting to really legitimately ask how a lot of the work that you've been doing, Brahm, that you've been doing, I think talks about literacy as in particularly with emphasizing decoding and reading for meaning. In that paper, we put forward on the four resources model, which says that there are lots of other aspects to literacy. There's the what we call the pragmatic aspect and the critical aspect, but even young children need to engage with real texts and authentic literacy activities. And they really need to, young children can really think critically and ask critical questions. And I'm worried, I think when we need to think carefully about our theory of literacy. Literacy is both a very common sense as well as a very uncommon sense thing. And I think that we really have to sort of delve into what it is that we mean by literacy before we want to start making lots and lots of assumptions about what works and what doesn't work. So I'm just wanting to know, how do you think about those, the critical aspect of foundational phase literacy, children engaging critically. I was really thrilled with what Wendy was saying about her learners bringing critical questions and requests and wanting to really engage critically. I know you're talking about older learners, but I think we have to engage with that at foundation as well. I also think that what we haven't addressed, what hasn't come up tonight sufficiently is the issue of language policy. And I think that the absolutely devastating effects of the switch to English in grade four. It's all very well to say, yes, we know that, that's the common sense thing as well, that if people want their children to learn in English and so on. But the switch is has absolutely devastating effects. And when we talk about the issues of failing children throughout the school and so throughout all the years of schooling, we're not actually addressing that. at all. And then I think the third point I want to make is just thanks so much to the high school teacher here as well, who talked about the social conditions under which teachers are living. We constantly are blaming the teachers, we're blaming the schools. We have come from a devastating legacy of apartheid, and the social conditions are impacting absolutely hugely on our schools. And I don't think we should be separating off what's happening in schools from what's happening more broadly in our society. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So the first question about the, I think the first one was a comment by Janet. The one on the quantity of teachers coming into universities and the quality control of teachers. So Paula Armstrong did her PhD thesis on this in 2015. So there is some work, and there's also a book by Hendrik van Boekhuizen that looked at the same thing in 2016. So there is some data on this, which follows the matric cohort of 2008 into and through universities, and that's all universities, and we can look at the teachers as one subcomponent, anyone that enrolls in education faculty, vast majority of them are studying teaching. The first thing we know is that it's the lowest number of matric points that you need to study teaching, which Janet mentioned. It's actually not true. There's one thing that's lower, and that's military studies, which is also offered at Stellenbosch. But the point is you need a very low number of points to become a teacher. The second one is that the entire teacher education profession rises and falls with UNISA. So 50% of teachers that enroll in teacher education are enrolling at UNISA. Only a third of graduating teachers are graduating from UNISA because they have lower graduation rates. But I think, for example, if we think of a very prominent university like UCT, the number of students that are enrolling at UCT or Stellenbosch are minuscule in comparison to UNISA, Northwest University, which also has a large number, and UJ. So just from a quantity point of view, the quality of education that UNISA is offering its students, which, and I also have a lot of empathy for them, it's a very difficult thing to do. And they get the weakest of all of the students that enroll in their program. So I would answer your question, we basically need to fix UNISA, which is also something that we engage in with, which they also know they need to do that. The second question around the authentic literacy experiences that Kathy raised, I've read that paper that you guys wrote, and I think it's a helpful thing to document what the view is, which I've also mentioned. Our theory of literacy isn't one of kind of meaningless decoding, you know, the usual thing. And we do have modules on children's literature, vocabulary, comprehension. I mean, I brought some of our lesson plans here as well, which you're welcome to come and look at, to kind of see what are the listening and speaking experiences, what are the comprehension exercises, etc. I think the notion that there's either meaningless decoding or this alternative, which is super rich text experiences, is a false dichotomy. And one that's kind of rooted in the past. I personally don't buy into that. And I think that all of our materials are online. All the videos that we use to train our teachers are on YouTube for anyone to download and use. So it's a very open access approach to doing it. I think regarding the language policy, it's quite difficult to think of alternatives than parents choosing the language, which is currently what the law is. So unless we say to parents, we know better than you what's right for your kids and change the language policy in that way, or educate parents better that this is the approach that's best for your kids. The approach we've taken is that 3 years of mother tongue instruction is actually enough if you teach it properly to get children completely fluent and literate in their home language. Yes, they should continue with their home language beyond grade 3. But these are transparent languages that if you look at other transparent languages, the 3 years that it takes to learn to read is based on English norms and French norms, which are actually much more difficult languages to learn than most of the African languages and Afrikaans. In some instances, some of the researchers are saying you can teach children early access in a year. Now, we don't take that approach, but that's why we're sticking to the 3 years. And maybe it's a legitimate discussion to say, well, if children haven't learned to read for meaning by the end of grade 3, they should continue in their home language until they can before trying to switch. It's pretty pointless switching kids into English if they haven't learned to read for meaning in their home language. But I also think that if we push that deadline to grade 5 or grade 6, it's 6 years of bad literacy instruction. I'm not sure how much better that is than 3 years of bad literacy instruction. And then the last point that you made around the social conditions of schooling, I totally agree. I think that it's very difficult to hold teachers accountable for being demotivated, for not wanting to come to school, not just when there's a lot of marketing, but when there's the toilet facilities that are basic dignity issues that are available, and when you've got kids that have got a five-year learning backlog. It's difficult to stay motivated when your child that's in grade 9 and you meant to be the history teacher and they're battling with kind of basic reading comprehension in English. To not just get dejected and demotivated and to try and do something, I think you end up just switching off as a coping mechanism in many instances.
See, I think we're in dangerous territory here. And part of the reason is that we don't think comparatively. We really do think South Africa is exceptional. We're not exceptional. We're not the only country to have experienced colonialism and apartheid just in this region. And so we talk ourselves into a spin that, oh, we suffer so much, you know, and there's so much going on, and it's been bad for us. Well, it hasn't been bad for many of you. It's been bad for some of us, okay? And the danger that comes with that is that you then declare people helpless in the face of some very real challenges. I think the people in Mozambique were destroyed, by the war between Renamo and UNITA. I think they can talk about direct contact war that really destroyed much of that, of the countryside. I think Namibia actually had the only genocide, or near genocide of the Herero, you know, but you go there and you don't have this great angst that we put on ourselves. So I still think you get paid, you showed up. I still think if you struggle, you know, many of us taught 60 kids, 70 kids in a classroom, you show up and you try to make it work. And so this you saw this also with the student protest, this sort of extreme self-absorption and self, you know, flagellation, and oh my God, we are so hopeless. That has its own dilemmas, in my view. So what do we do with the strength we have? What do we do with the resources we have? How do we act on our own, the agency thing? On our own conditions, I think it's a really, really important thing. I don't know why you want to theorize literacy. Why is it that for years kids were taught basically how to read and how to write and well? Okay, you don't find this angst about theories of literacy, you know, in any of the Southern Africa. You don't find this in Zimbabwe. And Zimbabwe gives us the best trained students. They give us the best trained students. I would hire, I used to actively recruit students, in fact. You want to talk? I used to actively recruit students from Zimbabwe precisely because they were there. So again, we can academicize some of the stuff that we bring in the place. We can declare ourselves helpless, you know, and so on. At the end of the day, I still have to get up tomorrow and teach. And I have to make things work for the kids, because at the end of the day, it's not about me as a teacher. It is about the fate of our children. And so I look to the schools, the teachers, who actually, against great odds, try to make things work. And so, and let me also just say this, especially for us who are not mother tongue speakers. Nick is absolutely correct. That's where he was going. I think it is disingenuous for us as middle class English speakers to go tell black parents what language that is. They have, black parents have, like any other parent, summarize the political economy of this country, watch what languages get you ahead and what does not. That is earlier research that Nick did. If it's bad teaching, it's bad teaching in any language. That is our problem. And so on and so forth. So we must be very careful about how we characterize. I would not characterize teachers the way Janet did, if that's your name. I just did a 1.5-hour lecture yesterday to about 300 student teachers at the Cape University of Technology. I'll admit I had my own stereotypes about ULTs, but I tell you, there's nothing wrong with the student teachers. They are excited, they are intelligent, they are smart. Provided we teach them well and prepare them well, I think we will do well. And then finally, I just want to get back to the UNISA story. I wrote an article a few weeks ago about why I think UNISA should probably close. But the devastation of underprepared teachers, for all the reasons mentioned, in the bulk coming out of UNISA is one of the reasons I'm not optimistic that we turn this ship around down the road.
UNISA's, you know, like in corporates we say things are too big to fail, like the banks. UNISA's too big to fail. So there was a threat that they would lose accreditation of their BA degree. And literally, it can't. because the number of teachers that come out of there that go into the schooling system, literally just warm bodies in front of humans, the powers that be deemed it that it's too big, we can't have that. It's one thing if XYZ university that's not UNISA loses its accreditation for engineering or architecture or whatever. It's another thing if you say we have 50,000 fewer teachers going out into the schooling system, which may be a good thing. But then, you know, your approach, radical approaches of like shut down the whole school system for a year, let's retrain everyone. You know, you did.
That was 50 years ago, man.
No, this is close to point, but it's almost like understanding the political economy of like, are those types of things possible? What would we do if UNISA did shut for 2 years or 3 years? And it's also like the political economy of saying, what is workable? Is it workable to tell the ANC to take on SATU in a particular way? You can say that, but when you speak to the people in the department and they say, this is how we think it's most productive to engage with SATU, and this is not the official line, this is the behind the scenes line of this is how you move forward. These are the types of deals that need to be made to ensure that you have productive, like the unions actually bless your teacher development thing and come to the training and work forward, as opposed to saying, you know, fire everyone that's...
No, I don't believe UNISA should be shut down, seriously. But it does mean that we make certain policy and political choices, the consequences of which we should live with. Kada Asma was correct when he tried to shut down all the Sisulu University. I mean, I don't know if you guys know what's happening at some of these places. Okay. The students are being given a microwave version of frontier education. It's as simple as that. But Nelson Mandela intervened and said, no, but you can't, you know, this is where my people are from. The political stakes are very high. I understand that too. I'm a political realist. My point simply is we must then live with the consequences of not acting on these things.
I think we have to wrap up. Sorry, but you can continue your conversations with the panelists afterwards. Is there anything any of you would like to say just to sum up from your side?
Yeah, I went. Deny an opportunity to speak. I think the pertinent question is, what do we do with our time and limited resources? And we can talk about accountability till we blue in the face with the political economy that we have, or we can put our time, effort, and money into proven capacity development strategies that we all believe work with teachers, and there's large-scale evidence that it works, and make traction. Make headway and get kids learning to read for meaning in their home language and prioritize the foundation phase. We know how to do it. Let's allocate resources to do that.
Thank you. Wendy?
No, I think it's a great opportunity to be here. I just would like to maybe end on a positive note. And I know it's dismal and we're all tired and we're all teachers that are here, many of you. But when I meet with my colleagues who want to learn, when I go to the CTLI and I see teachers coming in their holidays to train on whatever they're training, and maybe the training's not so great, but they're all there enthusiastically training on whether it be tablets or learning, reading foundation phase things. They've got a whole maths program, and these teachers come in their own time to do it. There has to be some positivity taken out of that, that there are teachers who know they don't know. And there are teachers who are doing their very best to try and know. And I think we need to take something out of that.
John. The most important lesson I learned in studying education is to think relationally. In other words, not to think of the problems of schools as residing necessarily within the schools. To change the system, you need a government. This is not the kind of government that is prepared to change that system. You also fool yourself when you think you can only change a system through good policy and good research. You also change it, especially in developing countries, through good politics. And we need to ask, what is the role of actors in bringing to attention the vast inequalities, okay, that are allowed to continue and that make it very, very difficult, apart from the ameliorative kinds of strategies that we all engage in to help schools, et cetera, et cetera. I spend most of my time in schools trying to give a sense of hope. That's what I do. But I also think when you have an opportunity like this, you also need to do a hard analysis of why we are where we are, okay, in order to be able to address these issues. But I'm not optimistic, I'll be honest with you, that the system will change, that some schools will change, that the research will improve. that will give some hope here, there, and the other place. That will always happen because of the good people in this country trying to make a difference. But for every child to get an opportunity to do well, okay, that requires a very different level of intervention. And we do not have the government that is either interested or committed to doing that beyond the rhetorical commitment.
Brahm, won't change your mind.
No, I think Jonathan has said something that's very powerful and hard to refute. I think that there are really serious challenges that have to be addressed and have to be named. So, but I do think that there is a space, and it's not a big space, and it's not a space that necessarily will be open forever. But I think there is a space for people like us to work systematically, to work with the system. And I think that we've got to use and seize that space. We can't surrender it until a different political dispensation or a new set of political actors come. So I think we need to recognize the reality of what you're saying, but there is also a space not just for individual teachers, but people who do want to work systematically and across the system to work. And I think we've got to find both the political solutions, we've got to reward and recognize the outstanding individuals, but also find those niches, those spaces in the system where we can begin to make the change we want to see happen.
And that's how you drop the mic. thank you
very much.
Yeah, thank you to our panel this evening, and thank you to our guests. Okay.